Hello and welcome to the Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we will be analyzing the important news appearing in the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 25th October 2019. The topics to be discussed today are reflected on your screen and the timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. So let's start. Now this news appears on page number 11 and it is titled, Should Schools Have Prayers? Now the background of this news is that very recently a headmaster of a government school in Uttar Pradesh was suspended on the complaint that he was asking his students to sing religious prayers during the morning assembly. Hence in this article, two very prominent personalities are discussing the usefulness of having a morning assembly prayer and whether such an activity is allowed under the Indian constitution and if yes, does it run against the secular fabric of the Indian state. Now this discussion of ours will become relevant from the perspective of GS paper 2 under the category of polity, especially that related with fundamental rights and governance. Now usually prayers are considered as a part and parcel of a spiritual exercise, but these prayers do tend to have certain religious overtones. Now as India is a secular state, imposition of religion or religious idols on its people are contradictory to our structure of governance and polity. Hence, the moot question in this entire discussion is how important are the morning prayer or assembly in the school and how correct it is to say that these morning prayers actually advocate religious idols on young minds. Let us first start by looking at the arguments which are presented for having the prayers in the school assembly. Now, the first point is that morning assembly is a very common phenomena across schools in India. Furthermore, in the morning assemblies, prayers is an essential component which too is prevalent across India. The reason is that the prayers fulfill the purpose of having a musical and a lyrical component to the morning assembly. So basically in a school, morning assembly is used to fulfill several different kind of needs. Typically, the principal uses it to address his students or to give some kind of general notice or a short speech. Furthermore, in the morning assembly, there is always some kind of music and singing. And this music and singing is usually accompanied with a prayer. Hence, the prayers fulfill the purpose of having a musical or lyrical component to the morning assembly. The second major point is that the majority of the poems or bhajans are very basic to the cultural, literary and the aesthetic traditions of India. Furthermore, a lot of poems and bhajans such as those written by Surdas, Tulsidas, Mirabai, Iqbal, etc. form a very foundational part of the culture and literature of India. Hence, they cannot be excluded from the school's curriculum by simply branding them as religious because they are a very integral part of the culture and the literature of India as well. And considering the fact that schools are a foundation for learning, it is but important to teach children about the culture, literature and traditions of India. Thirdly, the National Curriculum Framework has stated that the school is a part of the society and the society's social ethos as well. Hence, in school, the children should be given the space and the opportunity to discuss and intellectually analyze the various things happening in the society. And since the society has its own social ethos, which are based on cultures and traditions, hence, in a way, we cannot alienate the schools from the traditions of our country because the schools essentially are part of the society and societies do dwell on culture and traditions. The fourth point is that there is a difference between direct religious instructions and the various traditions of religion. Now, as you must be knowing, a lot of us have studied about religion as part of history, be it Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Islam, etc. We all studied about them in our school, but as a part of history. Hence, it is incorrect to say that when we were learning about Buddhism and Jainism and about its various teaching, that was religious instruction per se. Because when we were speaking about the basic tenets of Jainism, Hinduism, Buddhism, etc., we were not actually learning about the religious instructions, but we were learning about the tradition and the history of that religion. Hence, the basic argument is that why is it correct to learn about a religion as part of a history, but not to learn about religion through its culture and tradition. Because it is a well-accepted fact that poetry, per se, is central to most of the languages, cultures, traditions, as well as religion in India. Hence, it is very strange if we teach the students about Sikhism without letting the children listen to Gurbani. Or it is very strange that we teach our students about the Sufi or the Bhakti movement without giving them a chance to listen to Mirabai's bhajan. Because all these poems and bhajans are part of the culture and a part of history and just are another way to learn about the traditions of the religion and per se do not constitute direct religious instructions. Because what the Constitution of India forbids is imparting direct religious instructions. But the Constitution nowhere says that children should not learn about the history or tradition of a religion. Furthermore, if we were to assume that this argument that the prayers in the morning assembly constitute a part of religious instructions, then following the same argument, we should also ban paintings which to have certain spiritual or religious overtone, or we should also ban the teaching of temple architecture which to tell us about the religious stance of various dynasties and empires. Hence, all in all, you have to appreciate that there is no watertight difference between spirituality and religion. And it is a very well accepted fact that children learn a lot about morality and spirituality through religion itself. Hence, in totality, it can be stated that the schools need to have a greater autonomy and a far greater intellectual space to engage the students with the heritage of our country. Because what is the academic study of religion if it does not include the experiential part to convert a topic into an experience? And it is here that these poems and bhajans convert the academic study of religion into a very practical experience for the children. Now, moving ahead, if you speak about the arguments which are presented against having religious instructions or prayers per se in the school, the main argument is on the basis of Article 28 of the Indian Constitution. Now, Article 28 of the Indian Constitution provides freedom from attending religious instructions. Now, basically, this article distinguishes between three types of educational institutions and allows religious instructions to be imparted based on this categorization. Now, according to Article 28, Clause 1, no religious education is to be provided in any educational institution which is wholly maintained by the state. The second category of institution is provided for under Article 28, Clause 2. Now, as per this clause, any educational institution which though is administered by the state, however, if the institution has been established under a trust or endowment which requires that religious instruction should be imparted in such an institution, then in such an institution, religious instruction or education will be permitted. Hence, the second category is of institutions which are established under a trust or endowment. In such an institution, religious instruction is permitted. And the third category is provided for under Article 28(3). Which says that any educational institution which is recognized by the state or which receives aid from the state funds. In such institution, religious instruction can be permitted, however, on voluntary basis. That is to say, no person will be forced to attend any kind of religious instruction unless that person so consents to do so voluntarily. And if that person is a minor in case of a student, then his guardian should give the consent for the same. Now, lastly, in the end, let us also see what is the view of the Supreme Court as far as Article 28 and imparting of religious education in institutions are concerned. Now, the first case is the DAV College Jalandhar versus the State of Punjab. Now, the State of Punjab had established Guru Nanak University with a view to make provision for study and research on the life and teachings of Guru Nanak Dev. Now, this provision was challenged under Article 28 on the ground that the university being wholly maintained out of the state funds cannot provide religious instruction. However, the Supreme Court rejected this contention in this case and stated that a provision for academic study of the life, teaching and impact of any great saint of India is not considered to as providing a religious instruction. Hence again, here also the court noted that there is a difference in imparting religious instruction and actually studying about the life, teaching and philosophy of religion or some spiritual saint. Furthermore, the court also stated that religious instruction is that which is imparted for inculcating the tenets, the rituals, the observance, the ceremonies as well as the modes of worship of a particular sect or denomination. Therefore, if a school is teaching students about the ceremonies or the way to worship in a particular religion, etc., that would be religious instruction. And merely just talking or teaching the students about the philosophy, tradition, or the basic values of that religion cannot be amounted to religious instruction. Similarly, in the case of Aruna Roy versus the Union of India, the Supreme Court again ruled that Article 28 does not ban the study of religions. The whole emphasis of Article 28 is against imparting religious instruction. Therefore, there is no prohibition on study of religious philosophy and culture. Hence, in totality, we can say, study of religions in school education cannot be held to be an attempt against the secular philosophy of the Constitution. And furthermore, as we have stated earlier, prayers are basically the practical manifestations of the theoretical or academic study of religion. And furthermore, considering the fact that poems are an integral part of any culture or language, we cannot isolate the poems from being imparted or being taught in the school. So this was all about this article. With this, let's move on to our next news. Now this news appears on page number 20 and it is titled, 2 out of 3 wild poliovirus strains have been eradicated, says WHO. Now this discussion of ours will become relevant from the perspective of GS paper 3 under the category of science and technology, and also from the perspective of prelims again under the category of science. Now recently the WHO, that is the World Health Organization, has declared that wild poliovirus type 3 has been eradicated globally. Hence in this regard, let us talk about polio and the polio vaccines. Now polio or poliomyelitis is basically an infectious disease which is caused by the poliovirus type 1, 2 and 3. Now this poliovirus is basically a single-stranded RNA virus. Now this viral basically enters the body through the fecal-oral route, and once the virus enters the body orally, it reaches the intestine and eventually to the bloodstream during the process of digestion. Furthermore, once it enters the bloodstream, it attacks the central nervous system of the body, thereby damaging the cells, causing paralysis, especially in the legs. Furthermore, the wild poliovirus 2 was eradicated globally way back in the year 1999. And now even the wild poliovirus type 3 has been eradicated. Hence, out of the three, only type 1 strain continues to circulate, especially in the countries of Afghanistan, Pakistan and Nigeria. Now coming next to polio vaccine. Now basically, two types of polio vaccines are used to combat polio. The first is known as the inactivated polio vaccine or the IPV. Now IPV basically includes an injectable dose of the killed polio virus. So therefore, under the inactivated polio vaccine or the IPV, we are using inactivated or killed polio virus. And the second type is the oral polio vaccine, also known as the OPV. Now in the OPV, we are using a live weakened version of the polio virus, which basically produces mutation in the viral genome, thereby causing immunity. So where the injectable polio vaccine uses inactivated or dead virus, the oral vaccine in turn uses weakened version of the virus. So under the OPV, the virus is not dead, but is rather in a weakened form. Now usually OPV is used more because firstly, it is easier to administer because it is in the oral form. And secondly, it also leads to herd immunity because the children who are administered with the oral vaccine can transmit the poliovirus vaccine via the fecal-oral route and then naturally even immunize others. However, the flip side to using OPV is that these oral polio vaccines can sometimes cause vaccine-derived poliovirus, which actually did happen in India last year. Now, India for the longest time under its universal immunization program has been using the oral polio vaccine. Now, earlier, a trivalent oral polio vaccine was used, which had all the three strains of live weakened poliovirus, that is strain 1, 2 and 3. However, since the last case due to type 2 wild poliovirus was reported from India, since type 2 was eradicated in 1999, India has now started to use the bivalent OPV consisting of only strain 1 and strain 3. In addition to this, considering the fact that 90% of the vaccine-derived poliovirus is caused by type 2 poliovirus, WHO too has recommended to switch from the TOPV to BOPV. Moving ahead, polio was endemic to India till 2011. However, since 2011, there were no reported cases in India of polio. Therefore, India was declared polio-free in the year 2014. And globally, polio remains endemic in only three countries, which we studied earlier, that is Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Nigeria. Additionally, you should know that recently, inactivated polio virus or the IPV has been started to use in the Mission Indradhanush of the government to tackle polio. Now, Mission Indradhanush was launched by the government in the year 2017 to accelerate the immunization coverage in India. Now, Mission Indradhanush, though originally included 7 diseases, has now been expanded to cover 12 diseases. These are namely tuberculosis, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, polio, measles, rubella, hepatitis B, pneumonia, Japanese encephalitis, meningitis, as well as rotavirus diarrhea. So this was all about this article. Now let's take up our next news. Now the next news which we'll be talking about appears on both page number 10 as well as on page number 15 and is related to India's remarkable improvement on the ease of doing business ranking. Now this discussion of ours will become relevant from the perspective of economy, both for the prelims as well as for the mains under GS paper 3. Now the context of the news is that in a significant improvement, India has ranked 63 on the ease of doing business index with an improvement of 14 places from last year's 77. Furthermore, this year as well, for the third consecutive year, India has been ranked one of the 10 most improved economies on this business ranking. Now let us know a few details about the ease of doing business index. This index is published by the World Bank. And as for the 2020 edition, the top performers include New Zealand, Singapore, Hong Kong, etc. Now coming to how ease of doing business is measured, this index uses 5 broad parameters, namely opening a business, getting a location, accessing finance, dealing with day-to-day operations, and operating in a secured business environment, which are further then divided into 10 sub-indices. Now under the 10 sub-indices, the first is starting a business, which includes procedure, time, cost, and minimum capital to open a new business. Second is employing workers. Then under the second parameter of getting a location, we have the subcategory of dealing with construction permits, which includes procedure, time, and cost to build a warehouse. Then we have getting electricity, which again includes procedure, times, and cost required to obtain a permanent electricity connection. And third, we have registering property, which includes procedure, time, and cost to register commercial real estate. Then under the third parameter of accessing finance, we have getting credit, as well as protecting minority investors. This protecting minority investors includes disclosure norms, director liability, ease of shareholder suits, etc. Fourth parameter of dealing with day-to-day operation has paying taxes. Second is trading across border. And third, contracting with the government. Now, this third parameter of contracting with the government was not used in the current edition, but will be added soon. And the last and the final, operating in a secure business environment. This includes enforcing contracts. And the last is resolving insolvency. Hence, for the perspective of prelims, please remember these 5 broad parameters. Now, having discussed about the ease of doing business, let us see what exactly worked for India, which helped it to improve its ranking. Now talking about India's performance, as stated earlier, India has shown a drastic and significant improvement, wherein from rank 130 in the year 2016, it has jumped to rank 63 in the 2020 edition. However, please note that the index measured only 2 cities of Delhi and Mumbai. Next year, it is expected that Bengaluru and Kolkata will also be added. Now India's rank has improved due to its improvement in 4 major parameters. The foremost of them is first, trading across borders. Now, India has improved its ranking in this parameter from rank 80 to rank 68. And this has been possible due to reforms in the trade procedure. Now, India ratified the Trade Facilitation Agreement of the WTO in 2016. And the ratification of this agreement has simplified the border management procedures in India, which include e-filing of documents, single custom window procedure, etc. Furthermore, the TFA has also helped to reduce transaction cost of imports and exports and facilitate smooth movement of goods across the borders. In addition to this, India has also upgraded its port infrastructure. The second parameter is regarding resolving of insolvency. Now, the implementation of the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code has started to show its effect, and India has improved its ranking on this parameter from 108 to 52. Now, the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code provide for a time-bound, uniform and comprehensive insolvency mechanism as well as the necessary infrastructure to settle failed entities including cross-border insolvency cases. The third parameter is regarding dealing with the construction permits, and India has improved its rank from 52 to 27. And last of them is starting a business. Now here please note that in this parameter of starting a business, though India has improved its ranking, however still, India still stands at a very dismal rank of 136. Therefore, India still needs to improve a lot on this fourth parameter of starting a business. Furthermore, in this editorial, the author has stated that though improvements are impressive, however, India is still below its competitors for global capital, particularly China. Therefore, the country lags in some of the key metrics such as starting business, enforcing contracts, as well as registering property. Therefore, the need of the hour is to improve drastically on these three parameters. Furthermore, the author feels that as far as the enforcing contract parameter is concerned, this parameter is actually about dispute resolution mechanism. Now, though currently India ranks at a very low 163, however, the Arbitration and the Reconciliation Act 2019 was passed recently. Hence, it is expected that this act will improve India's ranking in the coming years. Lastly, even in the previous years, UPSC has asked questions from the Ease of Doing Business ranking. In the year 2016, a question was asked, India's ranking in the Ease of Doing Business Index is sometimes seen in the news. Which of the following has declared the ranking? And the right answer is C, World Bank. In 2019, the question asked, which one of the following is not a sub-index of the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business ranking? Now, if you look at the options, B, paying taxes is correct, C, registering property is right, and D, dealing with constructive permit is also correct. Hence, the right answer was A, maintenance of law and order, because this is not a sub-index. Now, having discussed all of this, let's move on to our next news. Now, this news appears on page number 1 and it is titled Construction Activities Banned from October 26 to 30 in Delhi NCR. Now, the context of the news is that recently, a committee overseeing the implementation of the GRAP, that is the Greater Response Action Plan, has said that various hot mix plants, stone crushers and even the construction activities which generate dust will be prohibited in Delhi from October 26 to October 30th. Hence, in this regard today, we will be talking about the GRAP as well as the EPCA. Now, this discussion of ours will become relevant from the perspective of environment, both for the prelims as well as for the mains under GS Paper 3. Let us first start with the Environmental Pollution Control Authority or the EPCA. Now, the EPCA is basically a Supreme Court mandated body. That is to say, it was the Supreme Court of India which asked the government to set up such a body to control the environmental pollution in the NCR region. Hence, the EPCA was constituted under the Environmental Protection Act of 1986 by the central government, and then it was notified by the Environmental Ministry in the year 1998. Hence, we can say that the EPA finally came into function in the year 1998. Now, the main function of the EPCA is to protect as well as to improve the environment and to also prevent and control environmental pollution in the National Capital Region. Now, this authority acts on the various complaints filed by any individual, representative body or organization functioning in the field of environment. And in addition to that, it also has the power of suo motu cognizance, where it may take up an issue on its own discretion. Now, this EPCA takes all necessary steps for controlling vehicular pollution, ensuring compliance of fuel quality standards, monitoring and coordinating action for traffic planning as well as management. Further, it was this EPCA which has mandated to enforce the GRAP or the Graded Response Action Plan in the NCR region as per the pollution level. Hence, in this regard, let us now talk about the GRAP. Now, the Graded Response Action Plan was formulated and approved by the Supreme Court in the year 2016. And then following the Supreme Court's approval, it was notified by the central government in the year 2017. Now, this graph institutionalizes all the measures and the steps which are required to be taken when the air quality in the NCR dips. Now, this graph is incremental in nature, which simply means that actions need not be taken throughout the year to tackle the emission, and only when the air quality deteriorates, the graph rolls out progressively tougher actions. Hence, only when the air quality shifts to very poor, then all these measures under the graph have to be taken. Furthermore, the plan under the graph requires action and coordination amongst the four NCR states of Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, as well as Rajasthan. In fact, before the imposition of any measure, the EPCA holds a meeting with the representative from all the NCR states, and a call is taken on which actions have to be made applicable in which town. Now, the graph has been very successful because it has created a step-by-step plan for the entire Delhi NCR region. And the biggest success of GRAP has been in fixing accountabilities and deadline. Furthermore, if we were to really pinpoint the success of both EPCA and GRAP, then we can talk about three major policy decisions which can be credited to the EPCA and GRAP. First of them is the shutting down of the Badarpur thermal power plant. Second is bringing BS6 fuel to Delhi. And thirdly, it put a ban on using pet coke as a fuel in the NCR region. So these are the main points regarding EPCA, and these points will become important from the perspective of prelims. So with this, let's move on to our next news. Now this news appears on page number 8 and it is titled Andhra Pradesh likely had a flourishing port 2000 years ago. Now the context of the news is that recently the Archaeological Survey of India carried out an excavation near Naidupeta, which is around 80 kilometers from Tirupati and Nellore. Now during this excavation, the ASI found a fortified settlement near the banks of the river Swarnamukhi in Andhra Pradesh's Gottipullu. And it is believed that this fortified settlement was basically a maritime trade center. Hence the context is that in Andhra Pradesh's Gottipullu, the ASI has found a maritime trade center. Now what you should know is that so far only 10% of the site has been excavated, and the Archaeological Survey of India will soon start its second round of survey. Now, under the first round, the ASI unearthed a huge settlement which was surrounded by a brick enclosure. Now, this excavation unearthed brick-built structure in elliptical, circular, and even rectangular shapes. Now, what is to be noted here is that these bricks which have been found out in this settlement are very identical in size to the bricks which were found in the Satavahana period. Therefore, due to the similarity between the bricks, it is pegged that this site may date back to 2nd century to 1st century BCE, because this was the time the Satavahanas existed. Furthermore, in this brick enclosure, the ASI also found a sculpture of Vishnu, and looking at the features of the sculpture, which has a headgear and a drapery, the ASI says that this sculpture dates back to the Pallava period, that is around 8th century CEE. Moreover, in addition to these two, the excavation also unearthed a series of broken terracotta pipes that fit into each other. And this points toward a form of drainage which existed in those times. So looking at all of this, that is the brick enclosure and terracotta broken pipes, it can be said that this site appears to be a trade center which was located in the south coastal Andhra Pradesh, and hence can also be stated to be a very strategic location of that site. Furthermore, as per the excavation, it is also inferred that trade guilds used to control such centers, and they used to have their own armies to protect their interest. Therefore, the second major point is that such maritime settlement was used by the trade guilds, and these trade guilds had their own armies to protect their settlement. Additionally, evidence also shows that these guilds were given a role of administration in all those kingdoms which had a contact with these guilds. Hence, from the perspective of prelims, the location of the site, that is at Gottipullu near Andhra Pradesh, becomes important. Furthermore, what becomes important is to remember that a brick enclosure has been found out, which dates back to the Satavahana period. Secondly, even a sculpture of Vishnu dating back to the Pallava century has been found out. And lastly, that broken terracotta pipes have also been found out, which point towards a form of drainage. So this was all about this news. Now let's take up our next topic. Now, this news appears on page number 1 and it is titled India-Pakistan Signed Kartarpur Pact. Now, recently, India and Pakistan signed an agreement to operationalize the Kartarpur corridor that will facilitate pilgrims from India to visit the Gurdwara Kartarpur Sahib in Pakistan. Now, this discussion of ours will become relevant from the perspective of GS Paper 2 under the category of international relations. Now, since we have spoken about the Kartarpur corridor earlier in detail, therefore today we will be revising our previous lecture. Now, the Kartarpur corridor is a proposed border corridor between India and Pakistan. And this Kartarpur corridor will connect Dera Baba Nanak Sahib, which is located in the Gurdaspur district of Punjab in India, to the Kartarpur Sahib, located in the Narowal district in Pakistan, just 2 kilometers from the India-Pakistan border. The main purpose of the Kartarpur corridor is to facilitate the crossing over of the Indian devotees to Pakistan so that they can visit Gurdwara Darbahir Sahib Kartarpur without requiring a visa. Now, as you will see in this picture here, Kartarpur is located right here, whereas Dera Baba Nanak is located right here. The Darbar Sahib Kartarpur is situated on the banks of River Ravi and is just 2 kilometers from the India-Pakistan border. In fact, the length of the proposed corridor is about 4 kilometers, with 2 kilometers on either side of the international border. Now, currently what happens is that devotees from both the countries of India and Pakistan, if they want to visit the other country for the purpose of pilgrimage, such pilgrimages are governed by the 1974 Protocol on Visits to Religious Shrines. Now, this protocol includes a list of shrines in Pakistan and India which are open for visitors from the other country, but such visit is allowed only on a valid visa. In fact, the Kartarpur Sahib Gurdwara was opened to pilgrims after repairs and restoration in the year 1999. And ever since, Sikhs have been visiting the shrine regularly. In fact, the Sikhs from India travel to Pakistan every year, especially on the occasion of Baisakhi, which is the martyrdom day of Guru Arjan Dev, on the occasion of the death anniversary of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, and the birthday of Guru Nanak Dev. In fact, Indian pilgrims are given access to all Gurdwaras in Pakistan. However, considering the fact that Kartarpur Sahib is located just 2 kilometers from the international border, both the countries want to come up with an arrangement where pilgrims will be allowed to visit Kartarpur Sahib and return the same day. Hence, it is for this purpose that the Kartarpur corridor has been proposed, which will provide a visa-free access to the Indian pilgrims who wish to visit Kartarpur Sahib. Moving ahead, as far as the impact of the Kartarpur corridor are concerned, the first very obvious impact of the Kartarpur corridor, it will help to reduce the harassment and the burdens of the pilgrims who travel to Pakistan every year to visit Kartarpur Sahib. Second, though it is too early to say what specific effect Kartarpur corridor will have on India-Pakistan relationship, but it is hoped that this Kartarpur corridor will positively affect India-Pakistan relationship and will help to diffuse the tension between the two countries. Thirdly, it is possible that after Kartarpur corridor, people on both the sides of the border will start demanding more people-to-people interaction between these two countries. Hence, it can also add into India's soft power as far as Pakistan is concerned. Lastly, there is a significant concern, especially from the side of India. This corridor will bring Pakistan infrastructure right up to the nose of the Indian border. In fact, earlier also, Gurdwaras in Pakistan have been used for a pro-Khalistan campaign. Therefore, there is a serious reservation that this Kartarpur Sahib can be used by anti-state nationals to promote a pro-Khalistani campaign. Hence, it is in this light that the Indian officials are wary of the corridor being misused by both the state and the non-state actors in Pakistan. Now, the reason Gurdwara Darbahir Sahib at Kartarpur is so famous, especially amongst the Sikh pilgrimage, is because this Kartarpur Sahib is the final resting place of the first Sikh Guru, Guru Nanak Dev. Further, this Kartarpur Sahib lies on the banks of River Ravi and is located 120 km east of Lahore. In fact, this Kartarpur Sahib was the area where Guru Nanak Dev Ji assembled a Sikh community and lived for 18 years until his death in the year 1539. Now, based on today's discussion, here is your prelims practice question. Please pause the video and solve them. We'll discuss the answer after 5 seconds. The first question is with respect to polio. First statement, inactivated polio vaccine leads to herd immunity. Now, this is incorrect. It isn't the IPV, but it is the oral polio vaccine which leads to herd immunity. Second, India uses trivalent OPV in its immunization program. This is incorrect. India uses bivalent OPV in its immunization program. Therefore, the right answer becomes D, neither one nor two. Question number two gives us three pairs and we have to select the ones which are correct. First, ease of doing business and World Economic Forum. This is incorrect. Ease of doing business index is published by the World Bank. Second, Global Competitive Index and World Bank. This is incorrect. The Global Competitive Index is released by the World Economic Forum. Third, Global Innovation Index and WIPO. This is correct. Hence, the right answer becomes C, three only. Question number three is with respect to the Environmental Pollution Control Authority. First statement, it was created on the recommendations of the Central Pollution Control Board. Now, this is incorrect. The EPCA is a Supreme Court mandated body. Second, it monitors air pollution in NCR only. Now, this is correct. Hence, the right answer becomes B, two only. Question number four reads, recently from which of the following states has ASI discovered a maritime trade center? And the right answer is A, Andhra Pradesh. And in Andhra Pradesh, it was found near Gottipollu. Dear DNS followers, on account of Diwali, there will be no DNS on 26th, 27th and 28th. And the next DNS will come on 29th October. From the entire team of Rouse IES, we wish you a very happy Diwali. With this, let's move on to our practice question.